think in terms of the hospitality, and just to quote you, Filippo, you talked about the heavy duty Pakistan's hospitality. I think we should put things in perspective. And from my personal experiences, I recall this was in the early 90s, and I was a new medical officer working in the largest tertiary care hospital on the closest to the Pakistan border. And I distinctly recall 30% of our patient load used to be Afghans. We never called them refugees. We never put them in waiting lines. We never put them in queues and on hospital operation lists. We just treated them as our own. And I think it's important to unpack that word that you said, Filippo, and to understand very clearly that in this country, which had its own political and operational problems with a severe financial crunch, we opened our primary healthcare services, our hospitals, to every Afghan entering the border. And it has been 40 years since. We made access to primary education free for all Afghan children. And if you look back at that time, we're talking about huge millions of Afghan refugees coming through the border. For a country to exhibit that level of generosity is very unprecedented. And it is not just that we made access in terms of integration into the economy and the ease of doing business pretty straightforward. And if you go to some of our cities where they were passing through and where they integrated, the entire social fabric had changed. And that put enormous pressure on our infrastructure, on our public delivery systems, and the state exhibited enormous generosity, enormous and unparalleled generosity, and it wasn't just the state, it was the people themselves, because you had to be living in that city to understand the impact on their lives, because for those poor people, and some of them were poorer than the refugees who were coming in, the cost of rents went up, the transportation fares went up, the labor costs came down, so they were earning less because Afghan refugees would offer themselves for much less. Their business space was crowded out. Their children had less opportunity to go to school. They had to endure much longer waiting lines. And as I said, these were very poor people who opened their houses and their homes and the hospitality was truly unprecedented. And not even once during the course of those decades did I ever hear any statement that reflected a xenophobic attitude, unfortunately, which was exhibited during recent waves of migration. So I think as a starting point, we should recall, and Secretary General was very generous in acknowledging Pakistan's contributions this morning when he so eloquently spoke. So I think that there's that dimension of hospitality before we talk about now and what we can do that we need to put in perspective. And I was just propelled by your words of, to bring some personal perspectives to the table. What do we do now? And I think that there is also a tremendous opportunity for us to assist, but in a slightly different way, because we're talking about repatriation, we're talking about them going, but there has to be the pull factor there. They have to go back to something that's worthwhile. And I completely hear you, and I completely, because the word of peace is resonating loud. So peace brings investments coupled with the government's ability to accrue benefits equitably will create the job opportunities, and that will make it worthwhile for Afghans on our side of the border to go back, and that's accepted. But what is it that you can catalyze for the bottom of the pyramid? And that's where the Pakistani experience these days can come into play quite significantly. Because our Prime Minister has a signature initiative called ESAS. ESAS means compassion. And ESAS is a whole of government initiative to embed welfare into the mandate of all ministries. It's a social protection initiative. It's got allied livelihoods and jobs creation initiatives for the bottom of the pyramid to develop human capital, which we know is so fundamentally important for countries to progress in the economies of the future. And over the last 1 year, we've recognized that there are some strategic coordinated approaches that you can adopt to catalyze the economy at the bottom of the pyramid. We're very happy to share those experiences mm-hmm. with our colleagues across the border. For example, we've realized that by accelerating and expanding the cash transfer program, you can increase people's purchasing power, and that helps small businesses. For instance, we have come to believe that with some of the experiences that we've had with graduating individuals out of poverty, with some of the randomized controlled trials that we've conducted over the last couple of years, and the evidence that has shaped our policy around the graduation of very poor individuals at the base of the pyramid, we've come to understand how to combine asset transfers with interest-free loans with skill building. And we're in the midst of some massive interventions that we're rolling out. In fact, this Thursday, the Prime Minister is going to a very remote village to inaugurate an asset transfer program, which is built on the evidence from a randomized controlled trial, a very large program that we're upscaling. So these are the two pillars that we think are very catalytic for inclusive economic opportunities at the base of the pyramid. There are others that we have deployed at scale. For instance, the combination of financial and digital inclusion and what it does for economies at the base of the pyramid. But then with our own experience, we also understand that this is a very complicated business. It's about connectivity, it's about access to handsets, it's about telecom policy, it's about creative content creation. It's about a whole new paradigm of education. And then another important piece of what we're doing for these bottom of pyramid economies is our new initiative on rural value chain building. Where an expert group has accelerated its work to develop a new policy framework where we will actually create the incentives for private sector to invest in these small enterprises, which will help value chain building. And of course, you layer it up with digital, you layer it up with women interacting with access to handsets, and you layer it up with handset policy, with costs coming down, and there's a whole new opportunity that opens up for the bottom of pyramid. So I just wanted to say that there's innovative, cutting-edge work in a multi-sectoral, coordinated fashion, very much in line with the spirit of the Sustainable Development Goals, very much leveraging the potential and outreach of the private actors that is currently ongoing with various strands and streams. And of course, we have a partners forum where we have all the development partners engage with us to bring to the table where their comparative advantage is. Right. And with the leadership of our foreign ministry and the foreign minister, we're very happy to explore how we can technically cascade some of our learnings across the border, because it's fundamental to have the pull there,
right,
to have something worthwhile there for these individuals to go back to.
Okay, and I guess as we get the initial comments from Harun Shahansuri and we open it up to further discussion, let me take that and ask you, sir, as the only representative of the government of Afghanistan on this panel, foreign minister in an acting capacity, what about those pull factors? The long and the short of it being that for Afghan refugees, whether they are in Pakistan or Iran or in Europe or the United States or elsewhere, it is not a country worth going back to yet, peaceful enough, stable enough to go back to yet. There's an argument that, well, the Afghan government needs to get its house in order for people to come back.
Well, I think those fears have to be allayed, because we're not living in biblical times. In order to be entitled to any kind of social security benefits or any benefits from the state, or in order to operate in an economy, you need an identity. So if the Pakistani government is bending backwards and stretching its own system to provide that service to the Afghan nationals, which can subsequently be shared back with the sovereign country for them to use, It should only be seen as easing their constraints. I think we need a dedicated campaign around this, because I circle back to that, to the same point. Of course, this is about peace and trade and regional trade and integration and the rest of it. But at the end of the day, it is also about people. It's about that four-year-old girl who's been excluded from school. And it's about that 30-year-old mother-to-be who's entitled to have a delivery with a skilled birth attendant. And it's about that informal worker who should be in the formal system. And unless we are going to look at it from a people-centered lens, we're not going to solve the problem. I mean, hearing you all speak reminded me of the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Yeah. I completely understand that at the base of it is security. So unless there's peace and unless people are secure, they're not going to go back. We've had many failed attempts of international agencies paying them stipends, them going, crossing the border and coming back again because they haven't felt safe. So peace certainly is a starting point because we know that that's at the base of the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. On top of it is just food and shelter, and on top of it is economic livelihoods and respect and opportunity. And what I'm sharing with you is that there are ways to galvanize economies at the base of the pyramid. There are evidence-driven solutions which could be deployed. And I think that the international community needs to get out of that mode of thinking about this protracted refugee situation from a humanitarian lens. If we have to look at it from a solutions lens, then we have to look at the 21st century solutions that can really help you jumpstart. I mean, there's digital, and there's technology, and there's connectivity, and then there's this whole huge wild world of opportunity that it opens for you. I mean, in Africa, the Secretary will bear me out, we are seeing that countries are going straight to 4G and 5G. They are really leapfrogging to a very different era where solutions in terms of public service delivery, in terms of access to health and education, in terms of so many other things cascade into their mobile phone stacks automatically. If governments invest in connectivity, in reducing the costs of handsets, a few other strategic things will not just galvanize the economy, but will also benefit welfare in a variety of different ways. Right. We need to think about these solutions with a very different lens. For decades, I've heard about Afghans and them as being part of a big political theater, and that has to change. Right. We need to think of them as people, yeah. And we need to deploy the 21st century solutions, which the market knows how to deploy. This is no rocket science. It yeah. just requires a new way of thinking.
And it's been a privilege and a pleasure just facilitating this discussion as all these ideas come together and we wrestle with these ideas. I'm going to keep to time so there's no knock-on effect and we don't delay every